The Lord of the Rings is perhaps the greatest literary work of the 20th century. Not just because of the tremendous book sales. By that standard, 50 Shades of Grey, of all things, would be one of the greatest books of all time, rather than just, you know, filthy fantasies that tapped into the frustrations of the modern 40-year-old first world woman. Oh, and speaking of such things, it's also better than Game of Thrones, which will probably be forgotten soon if it hasn't been already, especially after that abysmal ending of the show. This is because Lord of the Rings is based on eternal themes of the human condition, which keeps us returning to it. We already know how the story will end. The good guys will win and the bad guys lose. There's no mystery to it, but there is hope and there is truth, which means that it has an eternal payoff that always gets us returning to it so that we can be reminded of hope in our darkest days. Meanwhile, A Song of Ice and Fire is based on mystery and shocking revelations more than anything else, and this is only effective once. The only reason why this story hasn't already been forgotten completely is simply because of the books haven't ended yet, which still leaves some mysteries to be revealed. But if it has the same ending as the show, then it loses any real appeal that it had. The great mystery. Who will end up in the spiky chair? Answer. Some stoned kid, high out of his mind, stuck to a chair. Because of course a sedentary hippie from the 70s would write that conclusion. Boom. Payoff over. Mystery revealed. I saved you 20 years of your life, waiting for the next one. The appeal of mysteries are temporary by nature, since once revealed, they aren't mysteries anymore. And if they're never revealed, then they're just teases, and nothing truly relevant. As for shock value, which is something that runs rampant in this story, it's only really shocking at first when it's surprising. Oh no, they're killing them! They're killing them! Ah! The second time? Meh, I skipped this scene in my rewatch. I don't like the brutality. Until I stopped rewatching because I realized the ending makes the journey pointless! Which leads to my central argument. The true source of greatness for a piece of literature is its longevity. If it manages to keep humans coming back to it over the course of several generations. This is because when this happens, it indicates that the work expresses something timeless and universal, and therefore something true to all people regardless of time and culture. Like the Iliad from ancient Greece, or the Romance of Three Kingdoms from China, or the biblical stories. People often forget that every era and every great influential culture tends to produce an Iliad of its own. Have you ever wondered what will be the Iliad of England? The work that will outlive England as we know it and still be read 2,000 years from now? I think that The Lord of the Rings is a great contender for this spot. Because to be an Iliad, you need three things. One, you need to be extremely popular throughout several societies and transcend cultural barriers, like how the Iliad was loved by the Romans. Two, you need to be popular and celebrated and consumed by all social classes. If only the snobby rich people in ivory towers liked your story, then chances are it was just based on an intellectual fad that made them feel good about themselves or something like that. Like Gone with the Wind, for instance. No offense, Americans, but that work will be forgotten. Unlike Star Wars, baby! That's the American Iliad right there. Pew, 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 pew. Explosions. Anyway. Three. The third thing needed to be achieved is, like I said, timelessness. It needs to be remembered, and it's only remembered if it speaks to some truth that is worthy of being remembered. In 100 years, when society changes and we stop producing romantically frustrated career women with no kids in their 40s, that's when 50 Shades of Grey will probably be forgotten, you know what I'm saying? Because hopefully society will produce healthier relationships by that point. But Frodo's struggle with the ring, which represents temptation for power, will still be relevant in 1,000 years, if civilization still exists by that point. Game of Thrones just has the first two needed to be an Iliad, not the third. And why will Lord of the Rings be remembered? Well, for one thing, the ending. It's way more satisfying than the crap we got in the Game of Thrones show, which by all indicators is more or less based on the notes written by George R. R. Martin. Even if he actually explains why things turn out so insane and why Daenerys goes cuckoo, such a nihilistic ending will still retroactively remove any meaning from her struggles. Even if not, and even if the Song of Ice and Fire books indeed have a different ending, whatever that means, there's still no reason to think it'll be as satisfying or as timeless as the one in Lord of the Rings. What is Daenerys' tax policy, George? Tell me! That's what I need to know! That's what will ensure that your work will live forever! Indeed, A Song of Ice and Fire has more realism, in the modern sense, than Lord of the Rings, which is more metaphysical and even more mystical. But what does realism in modern literature mean exactly? In the end, it just really means that it expresses how the author sees reality, and how his specific cultural background induces him to understand it, i.e. cynical hippie academics of the American 70s. This is not universal or timeless, as you can tell by the fact that it's only 2 years after the Game of Thrones show ended, and no one really talks about it anymore. Hardly anyone seems to rewatch it, even people from the same cultural background, but just a different decade. However, The Lord of the Rings is a different story, and this is because it's influenced by something much more fundamental to the human psyche than the Song of Ice and Fire's postmodern university fads, which are already demonized by younger postmodern university fads. Tolkien took inspiration from something that has already proven to be timeless and universal, something that is still growing to this day. Something many forget, and sometimes they just willfully ignore, is that The Lord of the Rings, along with the rest of Tolkien's legendarium, is filled with Catholic symbolism and themes. Examples of the explicit Christian imagery is, for instance, the scene where Gandalf is fighting the Balrog at the Bridge of Khazad-dûm. Many aren't really aware of the significance of this. Gandalf is not a man within Tolkien's lore. He's actually an angel, specifically a group of angels, or Maiar as they're called, denominated as the Istari, known by men as wizards. The Balrog he fights is a demon, as you can probably tell just by looking at the thing. It's one of the angels who fell from grace with Satan, or Morgoth, as he's called in Tolkien's legendarium. The blatant Morgoth-Satan parallels can be discussed in another video. Anyway, on the Bridge of Khazad-dûm, Gandalf lays down his life for his friends. During the battle, Gandalf proclaims himself a servant of the Sacred Fire, which is never really explained in The Lord of the Rings. Probably seems like it comes out of nowhere, and people start wondering what that is. As the Catholic literary scholar Joseph Peer states, I quote, "The Sacred Fire is nothing less than the God-given being of cosmos itself, the spark of God's life and the light in his creation." End quote. Frodo's Journey, Chapter 10, Words and Wizards. Also, when talking to American literary scholar Clyde, he openly says that the Sacred Fire is the Holy Spirit himself, thereby making Gandalf a self-proclaimed servant of the Triune God. The fire is secret because the fullness of divine revelation has not yet shone forth in time, seeing that this takes place tens of thousands of years in the past, since actually Lord of the Rings takes place in the past of our own world, within Tolkien's lore. But Gandalf, being an angel, is part of the eternal sphere, and he knows this. Gandalf sacrifices himself for his friends, and is gloriously resurrected from the dead. As it is written, "Greater love than this no man hath, that a man laid down his life for his friends." Wait, what? No, I'm not actually saying that Gandalf is Jesus Christ. Gandalf is merely an angel, but he does represent Christ in this scene. He also represents higher clerical authority. Like in this scene, Gandalf is pretty much acting like the Pope. Compare that to this, but we can talk about that later. Now we come to this part. This is, of course, reminiscent of Christ's glorious resurrections from the dead and his own transfiguration. Pierce again talks about how the point of Gandalf's resurrection from the dead is the turning of the tide against Sauron and, by extension, against his master Morgoth. This is what Tolkien calls a eucatastrophe, which is a sudden and joyous turn. Another thing is that even though it is much more explicit in the film, Gandalf clearly exorcises King Theoden. Since Saruman has, by his own free will, chosen to become a demon, even though this is just a thing in Lord of the Rings, in actual Catholic theology, angels don't become demons like this after they make their first choice in creation. But I digress. So if you think about it, The Lord of the Rings is literally built on similar foundations that support entire civilizations. These are themes, ideas, and concepts which have already proven to be timeless and long-lasting. People that say Christianity just spread because of colonialism are being ignorant, because Christianity is still spreading as one of the most popular religions and still converting millions, while European Christian empires are long gone. And even though a Frenchman once said to me, "But Christianity is in decline and losing members, it might not exist in places like France anymore." That's only partially true. Christianity is declining in the West, which is itself declining and losing its population. But Christianity is growing in places that are going through population growth, which means that Christianity will definitely still be around. It's France that might not be. This means that The Lord of the Rings is an iteration of Christian themes from an English perspective. And this has ensured that certain unique aspects of English culture will probably persist in the imagination of future generations, of civilizations yet to come, who will continue to read The Lord of the Rings for its universal themes, and yet encounter English particularities The same way that we read the Odyssey today for its epic story about a lost man finding his way home, and we encounter funny little Greekisms like their phobia for giants with one eyes and their propensity to ingest psychedelics in the form of lotus flowers, apparently. In comparison, A Song of Ice and Fire is an iteration of postmodern doctrines and American liberalism generally found in Western universities and the intelligentsia, which is where George R. R. Martin comes from and what formulated his outlook and his worldview. His books are filled to the brim with anti-monarchism, as kings are either cartoonishly evil demon childs or Homer Simpson with a crown. It's almost as if it's personal. Anyway, this anti-monarchist attitude is pretty standard American, but these books are also anti-authority in general, as traditional father figures are revealed to be horrible human beings, and other leadership systems in this world don't seem to be much better than the monarchy. And any sort of traditional archetype is quote-unquote deconstructed, which is postmodern speak for slandered while pretending it's an intellectual exercise. The noble heroic man in Eddard Stark is killed because of his nobility, and although many other horrible characters get their justice, the heroes, quote-unquote, become just as vicious as the story progresses, as the evil bastards we hate. The only difference is that we saw the heroes grow up, really. Also, the stories tend to view any sort of traditional value or role with a thick pair of cynical glasses stolen right from Foucault's STD-ridden corpse. There is no real greater meaning behind the purpose of the narrative, besides, oh, the world is cruel and terrible and humans squabble all the time. And there's no real solution proposed for the problems it brings attention to. And yes, I am aware that the show is far worse than the books, and I know that the books are more subtle in the messaging, but if you read George R. R. Martin's other works like In the House of the Worm, you see he's very consistent in strawmanning traditional values as well as having tragic nihilistic endings. A Song of Ice and Fire is indeed similar to The Lord of the Rings and even professes similar values, like how the little guy can become very powerful because of his inner strength. Yet in the end, there's no clear moral objectivity. The books are all about the randomness and the cruel nature of the world, and if there are metaphysical gods behind the scenes, they seem to be just as cruel as the petty mortals. There is no satisfying ending that can be reached from this outlook. If it does produce a hopeful ending, it will seem out of place with the established nature of this universe. I mean, could you imagine a happy ending after all this crap happens? People defend the attitude within the books and show by saying, oh, it's realistic. It's just realistically portraying the horror of reality. But do you think that George R. R. Martin, living in a sheltered life in the height of American power, who mostly spent his life just reading and sitting on his chubby hindquarters making stuff up for a living, understands more about the brutality of man than J. Freaking Tolkien, who fought in the most brutal war in human history, and during the decline of his empire, no less? And yes, World War I was tougher to fight in as a soldier than World War II. World War II was just worse because of its tragic civilian deaths as the war crushed entire cities to dust. But World War I was fought by 19th century men clueless about the implications of 20th century industrial scale war, which led to entire armies of men being absolutely destroyed on a massive scale. Anyway, The Lord of the Rings is not silly escapist fantasy to the A Song of Ice and Fire's mature encounter with reality. The former is actually a true representation of the real nature of evil and an exploration of the virtue needed to defeat it, while the latter is a mix of adolescent nihilism at worst, or half-hearted and incomplete exploration of the hopeful themes at best. The two works are hardly comparable. In reality, A Song of Ice and Fire has already faded from the public mind. The two works are hardly comparable in their ability to last in the public mindset. Even if a Song of Ice and Fire series actually has pretty good books in it. I'm not actually saying that the works are trash or horrible. I'm just saying that they're not going to be cultivated in our culture the same way that Lord of the Rings will be. I'm not actually saying that Game of Thrones is complete garbage. But in reality, A Song of Ice and Fire has already faded from the public mind and will only really have a brief resurgence if George R. R. Martin actually gets around to finishing that thing, because then people will get curious to how it really ends or something. But he actually might not even finish it. If he doesn't finish the books, then future generations will no longer read it, finding it pointless to start an endless journey. And if he does finish it, unless he disobeys his own postmodern and inherently relativistic ideas born from a suicidal culture in decline, future generations will also not really care for it, because they won't be postmodernists like his generation. They'll be something else. Here is a controversial idea. The only reason why George R. R. Martin's story was a global phenomenon is because of American culture's dominant and hegemonic. You hear that, George? American cultural imperialism is the source of your success. And I don't say that as an American hater. Imperialism is inevitable, and as hegemonies go, America was quite benign compared to the next ones rising on the horizon. Yes, I said was, as in past tense. America is in super fast decline, and it will no longer be so relevant. Even in culture, it doesn't seem to dominate anymore. Americans themselves read more Japanese manga than good old-fashioned superheroes, and K-pop is dominating the music industry. But anyway, for a long time, the USA dominated the world. We ate American food, the future elite of the world were educated at international American schools, making us think like Americans, and thus American books and movies were hugely successful because of American dominance and the dominance of their ideas, which made it appear like they had universal appeal. But really, it was just appealing to everyone's inner America that was cultivated through an Americanized global culture. But now the world is changing. Now the East is rising. Asian food is more globally loved. Asian culture is more consumed. Asian armies are being more feared. With this, the mindset will change. The cynical anti-authority ideals in American literature and the individualist values rampant across Game of Thrones is already ceasing to be globally influential. And thus, with that, the A Song of Ice and Fire series will indeed be surely forgotten, as the predominant mindset of the world becomes more collectivistic, less individualistic, and more obedient to authority, because that will reflect the new hegemonic power or powers that seem to be rising. But A Lord of the Rings will not disappear, regardless of what happens geopolitically, because all cultures can appreciate the idea of the return of a noble king. Even individualistic, anti-monarchy Americans can appreciate such a story. Let this be a lesson for us all. It is stories that preach about eternity that tend to live forever, while those that preach about moral relativism or deny eternal life or just has specific views popular in their times are stories that are destined to die. Anyway, thank you for watching the video. Have a good day, my friends.